एनीमिया इज बेसिकली अ वेरी वास्ट टॉपिक एंड विल ट्राई टू रिकैपिचुलेट द सेलियंट फीचर्स एंड द इम्पॉर्टेंट कॉजेज ऑफ एनीमिया इन दीज टू लेक्चर्स. डेफिनेशन वाइज एनी एब्नॉर्मल रिडक्शन इन द नंबर ऑफ सर्कुलेटिंग आरबीसीज और द क्वांटिटी ऑफ हीमोग्लोबिन and the volume of packed RBCs in a given unit of blood. So it can be any one of the three which can be responsible for anemia. And the normal hemoglobin values in men and women, as you can see the reference values, it's always comes in a range where men have 13 to 18 gram, women 12 to 16. And for the different age groups, you have the these hemoglobin levels. Basically, anemia can, there are so many ways anemia can be classified, and one of the way of classifying it will be like it may be due to blood loss, which is very common, and it can be acute post-hemorrhagic anemia or anemia due to chronic blood loss. Then the anemia can be due to impaired red cell formation, which can be either a cytoplasmic maturation defects or nuclear maturation defects. Cytoplasmic maturation defects, you can have deficient heme synthesis, which is basically the what comprises iron deficiency anemia, and you can have deficient globin synthesis, and that, as we have talked about, is thalassemia syndrome. Nuclear maturation defect is basically vitamin B12 and folate deficiency, which also by the way is called known as megaloblastic anemia. Then defect in stem cell proliferation and differentiation, which is basically aplastic anemia and a pure red aplasia, where the defect is with the bone marrow. Bone marrow problem with the there is an ineffective erythropoiesis, and then the other one is defect in the bone marrow failure due to systemic diseases like anemia of the chronic disorders, where you have ineffective erythropoiesis. Then we can have under the bone marrow failure due to systemic disease, that can be further classified under anemia of the inflammation or infection or disseminated malignancy, anemia in the renal diseases or chronic renal failure. Anemia can be due to endocrine alone. So good morning class, back again amongst the gathering our thoughts amongst the chaos which is prevalent over here because of the repeated electricity shutdown and other technical issues. Anyway, we'll get back to our topic. So, we're trying to classify anemia depending on the pathophysiology. And one of the causes can be blood loss, so that is impaired red cell formation. Then defect in the stem cell proliferation and differentiation. Then there can be bone marrow failure. And bone marrow failure due to systemic diseases like anemia of the chronic of the infections and or inflammations or renal failure or due to endocrine and nutritional deficiency or anemia and the liver diseases. Then you can have bone marrow infiltration where due to leukemias or acute lymphomas or multiple myeloma, and then you have congenital anemia, which is a sideroblastic anemia where there is an excess of iron, but it can be due to congenital, mostly congenital, hereditary causes, and even due to in tuberculosis, when you give isoniazid, that can also lead to sideroblastic anemia. So congenital anemia is one of the sideroblastic anemia. It has one of the significant congenital anemia is due to sideroblastic anemia, and where you have iron excess, and iron is being seen in the RBCs as the basophilic stippling. Basophilic stippling is also being seen in the lead or copper poisoning. Because of the excess iron, and it's not being used for hemoglobin synthesis, or it's not properly complex to protofibrin in the hemoglobin molecule. So you have an excess of iron which is present in the RBC and which can be seen as a dots. And then you have congenital dyserythropoietic anemia. Then anemia due to increased RBC destruction, which is obviously hemolytic anemia, and as you know, it can be intracorpuscular or extravascular, but it is intravascular and extravascular, and there are varied causes for the intravascular and extravascular. Extravascular mostly takes place in the spleen and the liver. Intravascular can be cell membrane defects or the other enzyme deficiencies, which we'll talk about later. And then you have a morphological classification where it is based on the RBC size, hemoglobin contained, and red cell indices. You have microcytic hypochromic anemia, which is iron deficiency. Microcytic hypochromic anemia is a small and paler RBCs, which can be seen in iron deficiency anemia, sideroblastic anemia, thalassemia, and anemia of the chronic diseases. Then you have normocytic normochromic anemia that can be seen in chronic diseases, acute blood loss also, in hemolytic anemia and a bone marrow failure. In chronic blood loss or chronic diseases, usually have the first manifestation is usually as a normocytic normochromic anemia, or even in the early phase of iron deficiency anemia, you can have normocytic or normochromic anemia. And even this chronic disease can also have a microcytic hypochromic anemia. So all the causes, they tends to club over one or the other kind of morphological manifestation. Then you have a macrocytic normochromic anemia, or macrocytic in the form of megaloblastic anemia, and that can be due to the deficiency in the folate or vitamin B12. And then can other reasons can be thyroid and abnormalities, or liver disease, or bone marrow infiltrative diseases, or bone marrow hyperproliferations. Obviously, the clinical manifestation of anemia, basically what anemia does, either that can be decrease in the RBCs, which we talked about, which we saw in the first slide, or the decrease in the hemoglobin concentration or hemoglobin synthesis, or any decrease in the any decrease in the RBC numbers or hemoglobin concentration would lead to definitely decrease oxygen capacity of the RBCs, and as the oxygen capacity is decreased, that tends to promote a diffuse hypoxia, and that leads to myriads of symptoms. And basically very commonly you have in the form of tiredness, easy fatigability, generalized muscular weakness, lethargy, even headache can be seen. And in the older patients, because of the hypoxia, the tissue tries to extract in the hypoxic state, most of the cells in the tissue try to extract oxygen from the whatever the available oxygen from the circulation. And that can lead to further, that will aggravate further hypoxia. And in order to meet the body requirement of the oxygen demand, there will be a compensatory increase. There will be a cardiac compensation with increased cardiac output and increased work on the heart. And because of the increased work on the cardiac muscle, that can lead to hyperdynamic circulation and cardiac failure, especially in the older patients. And because of the increased demand on the cardiac muscles, it can lead to angina pectoris, which is insufficient oxygen to the myocardium, and it is almost a pre-sequel to major myocardial infarction. And you can have confusion and even visual disturbances because of the prevalent hypoxia in the body. Then the other signs of, as there will be increased cardiac output, there will be tachycardia, tachypnea, and you can have orthostasis, and there can be pallor, jaundice obviously because of the breakdown of the RBCs. Then can be increase in the indirect bilirubin levels, and then certain features like collinicia or spoon nails, which is very characteristics of severe iron deficiency, which we have seen in your clinics. Then there can be splenomegaly and lymphadenopathy, especially in certain hyperproliferative bone marrow diseases or certain bone marrow infiltrative. Usually whenever there is an infective erythropoiesis, or if there is intravascular hemolysis, these conditions can cause splenomegaly or lymphadenopathy. Then petechia and ecchymosis, that can be anemia-induced bleeding also. And atrophy of the tongue papillae is very common. So talking about the iron deficiency anemia, this is the most common cause of anemia worldwide and is frequently seen in general practice. And usually there is a defective synthesis of hemoglobin, which resulting in the RBCs that are smaller than the normal size, which is microcytic, and contains reduced amounts of hemoglobin, which is hyperchromic. Because there is an iron deficiency, is overall a defect in the available iron in the body, and that is usually diagnosed from the red cell indices, which we will see in the next few slides. And the drop in hemoglobin is generally a late feature of iron deficiency. So even with almost around a subnormal hemoglobin, you can have iron deficiency. This means that once the iron store is exhausted, then only there will be because of decrease in iron availability, and that will lead to defective synthesis of hemoglobin, but that will manifest a little after the it will manifest as a late feature of iron deficiency. So the first thing you will find out will be defect in the red cell indices in the iron deficiency anemias. As you know, the iron has a very pivotal role in many metabolic processes. And an average adult usually contains 3 to 5 grams of iron, and the majority of these irons are being used as an oxygen carrying molecule, hemoglobin, where it is linked to the protofibrin chain, and there is a site for oxygen binding. And a normal Western diet usually provides about 15 grams of iron, of which 5 to 10% is absorbed, and it absorbed principally in the duodenum and the upper jejunum, which is more acidic, where the acidic conditions help the absorption of iron in the ferrous form. And this absorption is definitely helped by the hydrochloric acid and the ascorbic acid. And the body has a unique capacity to increase its iron absorption, especially in the face of increased demands, especially in conditions like pregnancy or lactation or growth spurts or even iron deficiency. So we tend to absorb more iron in cases of increased iron demand. Once absorbed from the bowel, then the iron is transported across the mucosal cells to the blood, where it is carried by the protein, which is transferrin, which usually contains about transferrin is usually saturated in the ratio of 20% to 60% to keep developing RBCs in the bone marrow, and to transfer these irons to the developing RBCs in the bone marrow, and to keep the normal hemostasis in place or hematopoiesis in place. The iron stores comprise ferritin, which is a labile and it's a labile and accessible source of iron and hemosiderin, and it is hemosiderin is basically an insoluble form which is predominantly found in macrophages, and any excess iron, the irons have this basically is mainly stored in the ferritin, and some amount is stored in hemosiderin form. And a certain amount of iron, around 1 milligram, is shed from the body in the form of urine or feces, or tubular cells or epithelial cells shed from the skin and the GIT tract. And there is increase, especially in menstrual loss, may add up to 20 milligram of iron demand per month, and especially in pregnancy, the iron demand can be in the range of anywhere around 500 to 1 gram. So as you can see, the iron is being absorbed from the GIT from the GIT tract, and especially in the jejunum and the duodenum, and around 10 to 15% of the iron absorbed of the whole dietary capacity, and it is then it being transported as a transferrin protein, and around 75% of it is being used for erythropoiesis or hemoglobin, which is mainly responsible for oxygen carrying, and then other 10 to 20% tends to be stored as ferritin in liver and heart, and then you have 5 to 15% for the other processes. Then the causes of iron deficiency anemia can be inadequate intake of iron, which is very common in Indian scenario. And then you have any malabsorption of iron due to hypochlorhydria or any GIT problems, any gastrointestinal problems, any celiac disease or chronic irritable bowel diseases. Then there is increased requirement of iron in the growing child, especially during the growth spurts and in pregnancy. Then increased loss of iron can be due to injury or peptic ulcer, which can be another manifestation for chronic blood loss apart from menstrual and postpartum blood loss, or it can be post-surgical, but that will be mostly be acute. And then can be subtotal or complete gastrotomy. So the iron basic requirement in an individual or in an adult male is 0.5 to 1 milligram per day. In children is 1 milligram per day. In pregnancy it is almost tripled up, and any adequate diet which contains 15 milligram of iron, only 10% of which is absorbed. And normal plasma iron is 80 to 120 microgram. Clinical features, as we talked about, they can be pallor, polyuria, fatigue and weakness, anxiety, irritability, sleepiness, cognitive dysfunction because of the decrease in the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood. There can be palpitations. Hair loss can also be there, or feeling of depression and breathlessness can be there. And oral manifestation is very common. You can see it is manifested as pallor of the oral mucosa and gingiva, and there is generalized atrophy of the oral mucosa, redness and soreness and burning of the tongue, and there can be a fungiform papilla also affected, leaving the tongue completely smooth and waxy and glistening in appearance, and cracking and fissuring at the corner of the mouth is also very common, and recurrent aphthous ulceration and candidial lesions can also occur in iron deficiency anemia. And patient may show healing after oral surgical procedures. So one of the very important very interesting syndrome, which is a Plummer-Vinson syndrome, which is also called Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome. I thought I will just try to touch on this very important topic. This is one of another manifestation for the iron deficiency, where you have there is a triad in Plummer-Vinson syndrome. You have a dysphagia, you have iron deficiency anemia, and then dystrophy of the nails and the glossitis. and dysphagia is basically because of the formation of webs in esophagus and other features of iron deficiency like crack and fissures at the corner of the mouth, a smooth red painful tongue, atrophy of the phalliform and fungiform papillae, and then mucous membrane of the oral mucosa and esophagus are atrophic, and there is a loss of keratinization, collinichia may be present, and splenomegaly is seen. So this is just a footnote about Plummer-Vinson syndrome. Then we're talking about the hematological finding in the iron deficiency anemia. As you know, on a peripheral smear, you'll get a whole battery of tests, there's certain RBCs indices, and then you have a peripheral smear where you'll find microcytic and hyperchromic RBCs, and there will be a reduced hemoglobin level, can be as low as 4 gram, indicating the severity of the anemia, and RBCs numbers are reduced, MCV, MCH, MCH all are reduced. So talking about the indices, you have MCV, which is basically a measure of the average size of the RBCs. Then you have a normal range of MCV is 80 to 99, which will be lower in cases of iron deficiency anemia. Then you have MCHC, which is a concentration of hemoglobin in a volume of packed RBCs, and the normal value is 32 to 36, which again will be lesser in case of iron deficiency anemia. Then mean corpuscle hemoglobin concentration, then again is an average mass of hemoglobin per RBCs, which is normal is 27 to 31 picograms per cells, and again this will be lesser in iron deficiency anemia. As far as bone marrow findings, you can have a marrow iron depletion, and there will be a decrease or absence of siderotic granules from the developing normoblast. This is an early erythroblast precursor cells, which will be having absence of siderotic granules, which is the iron granules, and it can even the cellularity can be normal, and erythropoiesis can be a very normoblastic erythropoiesis with a small polychromatic normoblast, more of a early normoblast being seen in the bone marrow, and basically the marrow iron is decreased, and there will be absence of siderotic granules. If talking about the development of erythrocytes in bone marrow, the siderotic granules are basically nothing but comprises of iron granules, which are present in the early normoblast, which is the one of the earliest of the precursor cells for erythrocytes. And basically what happens when there is an because of the decreased hemoglobin synthesis, you can have iron granules which not been properly conjugated to hemoglobin molecule, and that will form a iron store or siderotic granule in cases of especially in cases of normal RBC production or normal erythropoiesis, you will have these iron granules being seen in the early normoblasts, and these iron granules, as the erythropoiesis progresses and as the normoblast converts into intermediate normoblast, from early normoblast to intermediate normoblast, you have these siderotic granules or iron granules which are present inside the RBCs. They tend to be used for being conjugated to the hemoglobin or to the globulin chains, and that forms a polychromatic intermediate normoblast. And so that the whole process is basically absent or decreased in cases of iron deficiency anemia. And then you have a biochemical findings where you have a low serum iron level. Obviously, if the serum iron level is low, the total iron binding capacity, which is TIBC, which is relatively high, and serum ferritin is obviously low. So the management is basically we have to understand the cause of the anemia. As we know, the etiology can be variable and myriads of reasons. So we definitely have to understand the cause of iron deficiency, especially in certain dreadful causes are like cancers in old adults, which manifest as a blood in stool, and that can be another cause for the chronic loss of iron through the GIT tract, and that could be the reason, one of the cause for the iron deficiency. And so the aim of the treatment, we have to normalize the hemoglobin level and the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, and individualize a disease specific management. And the lifestyle management is obviously, we need to have a proper dietary advice. Any new patient, you need to have a workup for the anemia profile, and if it's iron deficiency anemia, yes, then we'll first of all we can do something called deworming, which is a very important in Indian scenario, and then we can move on to the iron therapy in the form of IV iron or oral iron. And if it's not iron deficiency anemia, obviously we have go for further evaluations. And the most important diagnostic tests are CBC, MCV, then reticulocyte count. For any anemia, we definitely need to do reticulocyte count to rule out any hemolytic anemia, or this can be the one thing which can basically indicate the cause of the anemia. Then serum ferritin, TIBC and TSAT. So what most importantly, when you test for the iron deficiency anemia, the mostly these all will be in the lower range, except for the TIBC, which would be in a higher range. So the management, we talk about anti-helminthic therapy, which is a 4 milligram of single dose of albendazole given to eliminate any hookworm manifestation, which is very common in Indian scenario. And in children of less than 2 years, 200 milligram per day as a single dose. And in pregnancy, albendazole is contraindicated in first trimester, but it can be administered in second and third trimester. And the normal dosage, or this is basically elemental iron, which should be given on a daily basis. And usually the anemia will correct 2 to 4 months if appropriate iron doses are administered and and the whole process is properly optimized. And but we have to continue the iron therapy for additional 4 to 6 months. And severe anemia, again we have to increase the dosage of this elemental iron. And even after completing the 3 months of therapeutic supplementation, the pregnant women and infants should continue preventive supplementation programs. And since prevalence of anemia in pregnancy may be up to, in Indian scenario, it will be up to 80 to 90%, especially more in the North India, because especially for pregnant women, we prescribe 60 milligram of elemental iron plus 400 microgram of folic acid, and it should be given for at least 6 months in pregnancy and continuing up to 3 months postpartum. And the iron treatment, they can be in the form of greeny vegetables, nuts, dates, meat. And then oral therapy, you have different oral compositions in the form of ferrous sulfate or fumarate or gluconate. And then you have parenteral therapy, iron dextrin, which have a very historical importance. Now we don't usually prefer this because it has because of the dextrin moiety, it has a lot of anaphylactic and allergic reaction, and we have a much better iron in the form of Jectofer, and even a newly parental therapy or newly parental form in the form of carboxymaltose, maltose and iron sucrose that can be used as a intravenous therapy. The important about parental therapy is not the the amount of hemoglobin repletion or iron repletion or hemoglobin correction, But basically, the parental therapy is more important for people who need rapid correction, the timing of correction, and the second thing is especially the oral iron is very nauseating, and it has a lot of bloating and certain GIT disturbances. So it's not very conducive, and since all the iron containing drugs, they contain elemental iron in a very very minimal amount, so you might have to give them in twice or thrice doses. So that would be very inconvenient for the patient, and especially the patients who are not very amenable to oral iron therapy, they can be put on this parenteral therapy. And usually the response is seen in the first response to iron repletion is basically increase in reticulocyte count or reticulocytosis, which takes place as early as 1 week, and there will be then correction of hemoglobin by the end of the 15 days, and it will the hemoglobin start correcting. And then another thing is a blood transfusion, which should be given if there is excessive blood loss or congestive cardiac failure or any immediate replenishment is required, especially in a blood loss or patient have loss, if it's especially in cases where patient have lost a lot of blood, there we can think of a blood transfusion. Or even if in congestive cardiac failure or if a patient with a very severe anemia, we can think consider blood transfusion as an immediate replenishment for the iron deficiency. So benefits of therapy, it can be therapy benefits can be monitored through the certain symptomatic or rather certain symptomatology. Especially in children, you will have improved behavior and cognitive development, and there is a sense of well-being. And in adolescent, there will be improved cognitive development, and especially in girls, better iron stores for later pregnancy. And in pregnant women and infants, definitely it decreases incidence of low birth weight, and it decreases maternal mortality and even obstetric complications. So it enhances overall fitness and working capacity and cognition. This is all for the iron deficiency anemia. Because of so many snacks, we are not able to cover up the other topic, which I think we'll cover up in the next class, which is megaloblastic anemia and hemolytic anemia, and we'll try to wrap it up. Hopefully there is no further snacks in the next class, so we can cover up megaloblastic anemia and hemolytic anemia in the next class. So that's all for today. Is anything you want to ask, you can type in your questions and let me know. Anemia is such an important topic in ops and gynecology that it will be again undertaken by the ops and gyne people, especially the iron deficiency anemia. And the other aspect of megaloblastic and hemolytic anemia will take up in the next class. So anything you would like to ask, please let me know. So in the next class we'll talk about the megaloblastic anemia and hemolytic anemia, and then we'll wrap up this anemia part, and we'll take up AML and leukemia and lymphomas, and we'll try to wrap up hematology by the end of this month. Thank you, class.